Thompson.
Oh, Tom.
Hi, how are you?
I'm fine.
So listen, I was calling because we talked about, what did we talk about?
David Schwimmer from the TV show Friends makes his big screen starring debut in the romantic comedy The Pallbearer. It's one of five new movies we'll review this week on Siskel and Ebert. Also coming up, Sharon Stone as a woman on death row, Samuel L. Jackson and Damon Wayans in a send-up of boxing, and Pamela Anderson Lee as a comic book heroine. We'll also have a little chat with Tom Hanks as we preview our upcoming primetime special. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first film is The Pallbearer, starring David Schwimmer, the hangdog character from the TV show Friends, playing a hangdog character in his first major movie role. But this romantic comedy wears out its welcome because most everything about it, save for one other performance, is so self-conscious and labored, starting with Schwimmer's character himself. He plays a sincere doofus who is nerdy when it comes to women.
What are you doing?
That's Julie DeMarco out there. Don't you have any regular shirts? You know, like just a shirt?
What are you talking about?
Like that. That's a good shirt. Don't you have any shirts like that?
Yeah, I'm wearing it.
Take it off.
What?
I have to borrow the shirt, Scott.
What is this obsession with my clothes, Tom?
Look, I was in love with her, okay?
So?
So, I haven't seen her since high school. Imagine that. She sees me and I'm wearing the same shirt.
After a labored scene in which Schwimmer's character has to give a eulogy for a classmate he doesn't remember, he awkwardly tries to connect with his old fantasy, played charmingly by Gwyneth Paltrow. Oops, look out for that casket.
Come Julie!
On, what are you doing?
Where are you
here?
Going, Julie?
Come on.
Hey, what are you doing?
Where are you going?
I'm leaving.
Hey, buddy, you kidding with this?
It was just so sad.
Do you want to get some coffee?
How nerdy is Schwimmer's character? Well, he's even got a nerdier mom, overwritten and overplayed by Carol Kane.
Tom comes out this funny little hat and cape, and he has a little magic wand, I'm telling you. He was the cutest thing ever, so I got a picture.
Huh? No pictures.
Oh, wait, no.
Mom!
And here's more precious business as Schwimmer and Paltrow visit his bedroom and revisit their high school past.
I remember these.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
While so many scenes in The Pallbearer have a gimmick in them, a bit of business that is phony, contrived, overdone, I got frustrated with Schwimmer's character, too, because Schwimmer, the actor, seems to be much smarter than the nerd he's playing. And truly wasted in this film is the sunny, exciting presence of Gwyneth Paltrow, a young actress who appears to have many more and better movies in her than The Pallbearer. So thumbs down from me.
Well, I liked it a little bit more than you did, enough to give it thumbs up. And I'm surprised that you didn't even mention the major plot element in the whole movie, which is his affair with Barbara Hershey, who is the mother of the high school friend he can't remember. Now, what amazed me about that element and several other elements in the movie is that they didn't at least have the decency to credit Buck Henry's screenplay of The Graduate somewhere at the top of this movie, because this movie is basically a retread of The Graduate from one end to the other. But nevertheless, I felt it did have some redeeming things in it. You mentioned one, and Gwyneth Paltrow. I felt that Schwimmer did a good job with this character in making him into such a hapless loser, and then letting him have a parabola so that he's able to get a little more self-confidence.
Roger.
And I also felt some of the writing was
Roger, let me tell
satire.
Roger, let me tell you something about the playing of the scene. We saw a scene there with the shirt. Now, you know when you repeat stuff, it's overwriting. That happens an awful lot in this character. If you're going to make a nerd, why make him such a nerd? Why not have a little subtlety, a little smart? You know, the kind of, let me put it this way. Of the characters that are in this film, the one that is written the most intelligently is Barbara Hershey. Of course she is.
Yes, that's right, yeah.
And the main character is not written at that level.
Well, but another character that I did like was Carol Kane. I thought it was very funny.
Oh, no, that's overdone.
No, it isn't.
That's overdone.
No.
And you know that it's going to set up, if he tells her not to say something, you know, right back, She's going to tell him that.
Didn't bother me. Okay, right. Next movie. Our next movie is Barb Wire, starring Pamela Anderson Lee from Baywatch, another big screen starring debut here in a major role as the owner of a bar in the last free city in America after congressional right-wingers have staged a second civil war in the year 2017. She's a freelance mercenary and bounty hunter who, among various guises, poses as a hooker to get inside information and to get her man. But most of her time is spent in the bar she runs, where in this scene, visiting congressionals or government stormtroopers make some threats. Now tell me what movie this reminds you of.
Rumor has it that you used to fight with the resistance.
You shouldn't believe everything you hear. I'm neutral. I'm a businesswoman, Colonel.
Perhaps we can do business.
I can assure you, Barb has a very keen sense of commerce.
If you answered that the scene reminded you of Casablanca, you answered correctly. In fact, the last two-thirds of Barb Wire was inspired so closely by Casablanca that you can have fun identifying the scenes and the characters. Here, for example, is a scene where Barb runs into an old lover named Axel, only to discover that he is now married to a courageous freedom fighter.
When I learned that Topeka, Kansas was a lab experiment and that the congressionals planned to unleash Red Ribbon on the entire free territories, I defected to the resistance. It was Axel that helped me get out of Washington. Initially, we married on paper purely for identification purposes. We've been on the run ever since.
How utterly damn heroic.
Barb Wire has possession of priceless contact lenses that can alter a person's identity, allowing them free passage to Canada. And, of course, she gives them to the heroic resistance fighters and helps them get to the airport. So the pallbearer rips off The Graduate and Barb Wire rips off Casablanca. Now, I didn't mind that Barb Wire recycled so much of its plot from Casablanca because bad movies are remade so often these days that it's refreshing to see them remaking a good one for a change, ripping off a classic. But the movie never delivers on the underlying human tensions in Casablanca and is more concerned with special effects and violence and how many different ways Pam Anderson's brassiere can be photographed. Barb Wire is not a good movie, but it's not a boring one, and in the annals of trash classics, I think it's eventually going to rank pretty high.
Not with me. I'm amazed with the Casablanca comparison. I'm just thinking about what Ingrid Bergman would look like in Fredericks of Hollywood clothing, because that's really the attraction here, I suppose, is seeing Pamela Anderson, see if, whether her breasts are going to topple out of her cat lady outfit or whatever she's wearing. I mean, there isn't a whole lot more than that here, Roger.
There's a high energy level. They work very hard in this movie. They have a lot of
action. They have a lot of stunts, Roger.
Well, yes, they do.
I said they have a lot of stunts. I found none of them entertaining. Mm-hmm. Not a single one.
What about the atmosphere? What about the Sidney Greenstreet character who runs a junkyard and sits around in the scooper?
I didn't find him interesting. I think that, no, I'm telling you.
As a movie fan, though, didn't you even get off on any of the cross-references and so forth?
I understand what you're talking about, but I was basically had her being thrust in my face.
You know, I demand two things of a movie. This one only gave me one. It's not a good movie, okay, but it didn't bore me, so that's
right. It did bore me.
Okay, coming up next, Sharon Stone tackles a serious role as a death row convict in Last Dance.
If it's carried out, Cindy Liggett will be the first woman in 11 years to be executed in the state.
I won't die. I do not want to die, okay?
Well,
but if I do, it's going to be on my terms. Got that? My terms. That's all I got.
Sharon Stone plays a woman on death row in the drama Last Dance, but even though she delivers a fine performance, the film carries a big burden not of its own making. It comes out not too long after the brilliant death row movie Dead Man Walking, and, well, simply, Last Dance isn't in the same category. It's a TV movie by comparison because its script is so ordinary and predictable. Stone plays a longtime death row inmate convicted of murdering two people while on drugs, and Rob Morrow from Quiz Show plays another young lawyer assigned to investigate a controversy, her case for the clemency board.
Saying you go ahead and you make your damn report. Then you give it to the governor and you let him give it serious consideration. Then you can all go ahead and kill me with a clear conscience.
Ms. Liggett, maybe you can explain to me, what is it that you have to lose? I mean, there's really no good reason for you not to cooperate.
And then there's the standard scene where the young lawyer's lack of experience is called into question.
How long you had this job?
4 days.
So basically you don't know Jack.
And when things look very bad for Stone's character, we get a scene of her showing dignity.
I have screwed up a lot of things in my life. This one, I want to do right. I want you to give me something. Okay?
Okay.
It's not so bad.
What is it?
Now what comes next?
And how about this all too familiar jailhouse walk to death? I want to acknowledge that Sharon Stone does her best to get into a character here, but there isn't much of a distinctive character to begin with. This is a case of a glamorous actress playing working class. Last Dance shows her range, Sharon Stone's range, but it's not a memorable movie in any other way. I didn't think about it a minute after I saw it.
And here, I'm right in there with you, and it's, you know, I don't know how I would have reacted to this movie if I hadn't seen Dead Man Walking.
Right.
I still don't think I would have given it thumbs up because it's not really distinguished
in
the original, and the writing isn't that great. But on the other hand, coming in the shadow of Dead Man Walking, it's just fatal for this movie.
Sure.
You just can't consider it. You cannot look at a single scene without thinking of it in comparison with the much better film.
When we come back, Samuel L. Jackson is a boxing promoter who dreams up the next fight of the century in the Great White Hype.
This man money to watch brothers beat up brothers. I need a white heavyweight contender worse than white America needs one.
That's the setup for the new comedy, The Great White Hype, a boxing satire with a good premise but no follow-through. The movie stars Samuel L. Jackson as a boxing promoter who seems to have pocketed most of the profits himself while managing a heavyweight champion played by Damon Wayans. Now the box office gate is way down and he has a brainstorm. Find and groom a white contender to get boxing fans interested again. And they find one, a white hope from Cleveland, a rock singer named Terry Conklin, who once knocked out Wayans 10 years ago when they were both amateurs. The white hope is played here by Peter Berg.
I give my money to the homeless.
Good. Then if you take me up on my proposition and return to the ring, I guarantee that you will personally wipe out homelessness in America.
I got a bad feeling.
Jeff Goldblum plays a crusading TV journalist in the movie and interviews a persistent contender and his manager who think that they deserve a shot at the title. They're played by Michael Jace and Jamie Foxx.
Like my daddy said, you out there, James the Poodle, whatever your name is, Roper, if you a man, be a man. Step up, fight me. You ain't fought nobody. If you want to start acting like a man, then you be a man.
Just like my father had told me that when the green grass starts growing, you know, on the other side, then somebody got to cut the lawn.
One of the nice touches in the movie is the way Wayans plays the champion, whose ego is reflected in the wild hyperbole surrounding his boxing prowess.
Did this guy hurt you at all?
Not at all. He hit me one time, and that was just to wake me up because I was bored in there.
Bored?
The third round, that's right. And otherwise, it was just like fighting my little sister.
I have to admit, this movie fooled me and disappointed me at the same time. It started out so satirical and funny, I thought it was going to do for boxing what This Is Spinal Tap did for rock and roll. It really starts well, but then the movie loses its way. The characters get needlessly shuffled, the plot turns from satire into sitcom, and then the movie's big payoff seems so confused and unsatisfactory, it's like the last reel of the film is missing. The performances are on target, and the idea of a behind-the-scenes boxing movie is terrific, but The Great White Hype doesn't deliver. In fact, when it was over, I was startled. I thought, what are the credits doing on the screen? That's not the last scene. It can't be.
The conclusion of the picture isn't the best part of this picture, but there's a lot there that I was laughing at and thought was funny and smart. America at its trashiest in some way. That the boxing world, the reason why we're all fascinated about it is because everybody is out for themselves. Everybody is on the make in this picture, including the crusading journalist played by Jeff Goldblum. And that character isn't resolved in the best way.
Yeah, but come on now, Gene. If you can imagine a scale from 1 to 10, and 10 is the best this movie could have been, this movie just doesn't make it any
better. Oh, I'm giving it...
It could have been a lot better.
I'm giving it a positive. You can imagine
the home run this movie could have been.
Roger, of course. And you know why you could? Because it's a triple. Because you've seen it go nearly around the bases, not because it's a failure. Mm-hmm. Coming up next, are three high school girls really witches? The Craft is next.
She's Nancy. I'm
catty behavior toward classmates have often been compared to witches, but the girls in our next movie, The Craft, may be the real thing. That's the premise here. At least that's what their classmates think as the new girl at school quickly learn.
Hey, whatever you do, stay away from them.
Why?
Well, you see the one on the right? She's a major slut. I mean, I don't know from experience or anything, but the one in the middle, she's got these burn scars all over her body. I haven't seen them, but friends of mine have. Anyway, they're... No, never mind.
What? What?
They're witches.
That's Robin Tunney as the new student who, it turns out, has powers of her own.
Wow.
Are you impressed?
I'm impressed.
They proceed to torture classmates and relatives, but the only excitement in the craft is to wait for the witchcraft scenes. Nothing else is the least bit interesting here, and here is the girls' version of a beach party. I found sitting through the craft to be a depressing experience. Unhappy girls doing mean things, and the wait between the special effects excruciating at times. Thumbs down for me.
Thumbs down for me, too. I was disappointed in it. I did feel that the girls, that there was a germ of an idea
of
here.
Of course there was.
And that these four girls could have been made into more typical. In other words, if this had been Clueless plus Black Magic,
yes,
then you would have had a movie. But unfortunately, they weren't interested in the Clueless aspects, even though these actresses are clearly capable of having given
more.
Them anything like that they wanted. Instead, they're shooting low. They're going for the lowest common denominator, the dumb plot, the dumb special effects, the dumb payoffs, without any smart writing or any fun. When we come back, I talk to Tom Hanks and some outtakes from our upcoming Primetime Network special. 20th year on television, Gene and I decided to do a special show interviewing four people we think are right at the top of their professions. Actors Tom Hanks and Brad Pitt, actress Meryl Streep, and producer-director Steven Spielberg. And these Siskel and Ebert interviews will run at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 7 Central, on May 15th on the CBS television network. We talked for more than 2 hours apiece to our subjects, so there was a lot of good stuff that didn't make the final cut. For example, this exchange with Tom Hanks.
But people would say, oh, I could be Tom Hanks. Now, they couldn't. But on the other hand, okay, now don't get this wrong, there's an ordinary quality.
Yes. I think there are two things that the movies do to us when we're sitting there watching them. One is they make us aspire to glamorousness. There is glamour to it. And that glamour can be something that's very glitzy and something that's very Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, but it can also be Al Pacino in Panic in Needle Park. Mm-hmm. There is something that can be incredibly glamorous about that we know, I think, we can never go there, we can never be there, we can never achieve that, we would never fall to those depths. But even so, we're fascinated by it because it's just so glamorous. The other aspect of going to the movies is when we see ourselves up there on the screen, and we know that we're seeing ourselves. And I think both of the experiences give over to the same feeling of goodwill when you walk out of the theater.
And here's a taste of Gene's interview with Brad Pitt, who gave his first in-depth television interview.
Do you have the pictures that Nicholson had to work with? Are they even being written? King of Marvin Gardens, Easy Rider even. I mean, is California Easy Rider?
No way, because it doesn't move you emotionally. It doesn't get you under the skin. Pacino in Dog Day Afternoon was under the skin, you know. Nicholson and Cuckoo's Nest was under the skin. And I don't think the emphasis for films, certainly, that those films would be as successful now as... Well, I can't say that, actually. Actually, I can't say that. I think they would be. But, too, you got to give them credit because they took words on a page and they filled everything in between, you know? And a lesser man wouldn't have been able to do that. I don't think I'd be able to do it yet.
Tom Hanks, Meryl Streep, Steven Spielberg, and Brad Pitt. And that's just a sample of what to expect when the Siskel and Ebert interviews air on May the 15th. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this week's show. We split on the offbeat comedy The Pallbearer with David Schwimmer as a loser who learns to be a winner. I enjoyed its charm and humor, but Gene thought it was phony and contrived. Two thumbs down, but somewhat affectionately on my part, for Barb Wire with Pamela Anderson-Lee playing the Bogart role in a futuristic fantasy. Two thumbs down for Last Dance with Sharon Stone on death row. A split vote on the boxing satire, The Great White Hype. I thought it starts out well but loses its way, but Gene admired its script and found it to be surprisingly good fun. And finally, two more thumbs down for The Craft, which might have made something of its teenage witches, but settles instead for a meaningless plot that loses all sorts of chances for satire. So you liked The Great White Hype,
yeah.
And I liked The Pallbearer, and basically it wasn't a great week.
I think that The Great White Hype on the list is the most entertaining picture there. That's it for this week. Next week we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including Twister, the latest action thriller from the director of Speed. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.